Our call to worship is taken from Isaiah chapter 60, and we're reading verses 1 to 5. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the peoples. But the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look about you. All assemble and come to you. Your sons come from afar, and your daughters are carried on the hip. Then you will look and be radiant. Your heart will throb and swell with joy. The wealth on the seas will be brought to you. To you the riches of the nations will come.
Arise, shine, for your light has come. That is our Lord Jesus Christ. And his light in our lives just brings us life. Do you not think he is worthy of our praise? Come, let us join together in singing, Praise my soul, the King of Heaven.
Praise.
Happy, happy, happy New Year. I greet you this morning in the name of Almighty God, our Lord Jesus Christ, and I wish to welcome you to our service today. But before we start, may I take this time just to wish you God's richest blessing for the year 2022. I'm sure there are many of us that are glad that 2021 has come and gone, and it is something of the past. Many of us have seen a lot of uphill. We've seen death. We've seen bad things in 2021. And our memories back to 2021 may not necessarily be good ones. But my prayer for you today is that 2022 will be a truly blessed year, and that the Lord will journey with you, and that you will reach out to Him as you journey through this year. But today is the first Sunday of a brand spanking new year, 2022. Let us praise the Lord. Let us worship the Lord. Let us just give this year to Him and give ourselves to Him as we've come to praise and worship and just become silent at the foot of the cross today. So let us get started with our service. I'm sure we all celebrated the coming of this new year. So come, let us celebrate this morning with the Lord as we praise His name. And let us sing out aloud to Him, "Your people sing praises." Please join me as we come before the Lord in prayer. Come, let us pray together. Most gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, O Lord, we rejoice and we celebrate the beginning of a new year, Lord. But Lord, as we come to celebrate that, we've also got to look back in a year which had its ups and downs, Lord, and we must say thank you, Lord, for bringing us through 2021, Lord, that we can come to a brand new year, 2022. But Lord, as we come to thank you and praise you, Lord, we also know, Lord, that as we approach your eternal throne, Lord, we proclaim your majesty, we proclaim your sovereignty. But also, Lord, we need to confess our sins of a week and a year gone by, Lord. A year in which we sometimes lost our faith in you. At sometimes where we lost our trust in you, Lord, because things just seemed to keep going wrong. So, Lord, as we come now, Lord, before you, we just want to offer our hearts to you, Lord. And in our silence right now, we want to empty our hearts and say we are sorry for all the things we've done wrong. So, Lord, we confess now. Oh, dear Lord God, oh, Lord, we are assured of your forgiveness, Lord, because you promise us in your scriptures that if we do repent, you will forgive us. And, oh, Lord, as we stand at the beginning of a new year, what a most wonderful way to start the year, knowing that our slates with you are clean and that you have forgiven our sins. You've justified us as if we've never done anything wrong, Lord. And we go into this year knowing that you are with us and that it is you that journeys with us. Oh Lord, we thank you and we praise you for this wonderful opportunity of atonement. But Lord, we want to thank you most of all that you're a God that loves us and that you are our God and you are our Creator. And you've never neglected us, you've never forgotten us. But you've always been with us, no matter how tough the times have been. You've never once turned away from us. But Lord, we've turned away from you. And we want to say that we are sorry for that, Lord. Sorry for the lapses in time, Lord, where we just lost our rag with you, Lord, and lost it with one another, and where we said harsh words on other people. And Lord, when the time got tough, we doubted you. We didn't believe that you were still in control. Some of us even got angry at you, Lord, for taking a loved one in 2021. But Lord, we know that it is your plan that you have for each and every one of us. It is the bigger picture that we fail to look at. And therefore, Lord, as we stand at the beginning of this year, we want to pray, Lord, that you will just take our hands and that you will walk with us, that you will show us the path, that you will surround us with your love, and that you'll put your arm around us, Lord, that we may feel your presence, feel your warmth, and just feel your total embrace as you carry us through this time. Oh Lord, as we've come today, Lord, on this first Sunday of the year, we just want to pray, Lord, that you will just hold us very tightly and that you will bless us, Lord, as we go through this service, that you will speak to us and teach us and show us the way. So, Father, we pray, be with us now, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our lesson today is taken from Psalm chapter 72, and we are reading from verses 1 to 14. Endow the king with your justice, O God, the royal son with your righteousness. May he judge your people in righteousness, your afflicted ones with justice. May the mountains bring prosperity to the people, the hills the fruit of righteousness. May he defend the afflicted among the people and save the children of the needy. May he crush the oppressor. May he endure as long as the sun, as long as the moon, through all generations. May he be like rain, falling on a mown field, like showers watering the earth. In his days may the righteous flourish, and prosperity abound till the moon is no more. May he rule from sea to sea, from the river to the ends of the earth. May the desert tribes bow before him, and his enemies lick the dust. May the kings of Tarshish, of distant shores, bring him tribute. May the kings of Sheba and of Seba present him with gifts. May all kings bow down to him, and all nations serve him, for he will deliver the needy who cry out, the afflicted who have no one to help. He will take pity on the weak and the needy, and save the needy from death. He will rescue them from oppression and violence, for precious is their blood in his sight.
Come, let us sing our next song prayerfully and worshipfully. I know that some of us are not enjoying this time because it's bringing back memories of loved ones that we miss so much, or it brings back memories of happenings in our lives. And yes, it makes our souls weary when we go down a nostalgic lane. But let us sing to the Lord, and let us concentrate and turn our eyes upon Jesus.
Oh soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, he passed and we follow him there. Over us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, he promised. Believe him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, his perfect salvation to tell. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Come, let us ask God just to grant us the wisdom to understand all these things we have heard today and the Bible readings we've heard today. And let us just ask Him to speak to us through Amber-Leigh today. Come, let us pray. Oh, dear Lord Jesus, oh Lord, we've come today, Lord, to hear Your will for us, the purpose, Lord, of our lives, and to hear Your teaching to us. So, dear Lord God, we just want to pray that as Amber-Leigh speaks to us today, that You will speak through her, and that You will speak to our hearts and our minds so that we may absorb what it is that You have to say to us. Oh Lord, open our minds, open our hearts, and let Your wisdom come in so that truly we can get Your teaching. Oh Lord, Holy Spirit, we pray that You will just take control of Amber-Leigh, and that as she brings Your message to us today, that those words coming from her mouth will be Your words and Your meditations. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I greet you in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and might I wish you a very happy new year. May it be a wonderful year filled with God's goodness, mercy, and grace. As you might have noticed, our main reading for today is taken from Psalm chapter 72, and we read from verses 1 to 14. Now, this particular psalm is known as or referred to as a royal psalm, and the easiest way to understand why this is to pay attention to the first verse of the psalm, and it goes, "Endow the king with your justice, O God, the royal son with your righteousness." In other words, the psalm begins by referring to the king, and what follows in the psalm all pertains to said king. With that being said, I have a question for you, and it is a rather important one, might I add. How many of you know what Sunday on the Christian calendar it is today? It is the Sunday of Epiphany. Remember, I told you a while ago that Advent only comes around once a year. Now we are to start again on the Christian calendar, exploring all the big worded and unknown Sundays. So, what is the Sunday of Epiphany all about? If you were to go and search for the word Epiphany in a dictionary, you will come to find that it is defined as a revelatory manifestation of a divine being. I know, it sounds really complicated when described that way. So, if we put it in other words, the word Epiphany could be described as the revealing or making known or apparent of the divine being, who or which is usually the unknown. However, this revealing of the divine is usually done in some form of manifestation. In terms of Christianity, then, the Sunday of Epiphany is the Sunday in which we speak of and celebrate the revealing of God in Jesus Christ, who manifested in human form. In other words, Jesus Christ, who is not only the Son of God, but also God Himself, through His birth, becoming human, is a divine revelation, for we know something of our divine being that we never knew before. Make more sense? Now, the text we read today is very readily known among theologians as the text used for the Sunday of Epiphany, and over the span of 3 points, I'm going to tell you why. Our first point to consider this morning comes in the form of a question, and the question is, who is Jesus? Now, at first glance, this seems like a very silly question, doesn't it? Because we all know who Jesus is. He is the Son of God, the Son of Man. He forms part of the triune God, and the list of descriptions goes on and on. But what if we viewed this question differently? What if instead of just seeing it as a question, we perceived it as a key of sorts, a key that unlocks somewhat of a mystery? Fun fact, As long as I have been alive, our house is never quiet. My mom always has the radio on and tuned into none other than Radio Sonder Grenze, or RSG for short. This is an attribute of our household that even my best friend picked up on her first visit to my house. Now, I don't know how many of you listen to this radio station. However, every morning there is this program called Chappies, presented by a lady named Sue Peiler. And just like the back of a chappy wrapper, the radio announcer asks three questions to the listeners. And then, of course, if you think you have the answer to these three questions, you are able to phone into the station, and then the announcer takes your call and gives you the opportunity to attempt to answer these questions. It's usually the third or fourth person who gets all the questions correct. You know, when they have been able to deduce all the correct answers from the previous phone calls. So, in following the spirit of Chappies, did you know that our question, who is Jesus, unlocks our passage to reveal two epiphanies? The first one is directly linked to our question, who is Jesus? You see, when we ask the question of who Jesus is, the first place we usually begin is by looking at the day we celebrated about a week ago. We start with Christmas. We start by looking at the birth of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. In this first epiphany, it has been revealed to us that Jesus Christ is our Savior, the one who was sent by God the Father to die upon a cross, in order to break the curse upon creation. Now, if you're not certain what this curse upon creation is, then you need only think back to the story of Adam and Eve. In the story of Adam and Eve, after they had eaten the forbidden fruit, a curse was placed on all of creation by God, and the curse in a nutshell is death, or alas, spiritual death. And before Jesus Christ came to earth and died upon a cross, the only way to actually avoid this curse was to follow the many rules and laws within what today is known as the Old Testament. One of the most well-known books within the Old Testament in this regard is Leviticus. So, in order to break this curse, Jesus Christ was sent to take all of the sins of humanity upon himself and die, arguably, the worst death possible, in order to give anyone who believes and follows him a fighting chance, a chance to have an intimate relationship with God. It is a verse that our Sunday school teachers helped us memorize. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. In sum, then, our first epiphany is one that has already happened. It was where Jesus Christ was revealed as our Savior, our Redeemer, as the Son of God. It is a revelation that we still live with today. Now you might frown and say to me, okay, Ams, but then what is this so-called second epiphany if the first one reveals everything we already currently know? The second epiphany, that is also our second point to consider this morning, is one that stretches beyond our current into our future. However, the actual day or time of this epiphany is not yet known. The only one who knows when this second epiphany will happen, according to the Bible, is God the Father alone. This second epiphany is better known as the second coming. If you are like me, after hearing that, you are completely and utterly mind blown at this moment. And your first question would be, how is this relevant to our text this morning? Remember a little while ago I mentioned that theologians readily admit Psalm 72 to be the passage for the Sunday of Epiphany. The reason behind this comes from the thought that this psalm, written supposedly by Solomon, is actually a prophecy of the Messiah to come. However, it is not simply of the Messiah's coming, rather it is of his rule as king over all the earth. Now, if you thought that Jesus was the king over all the earth, I hate to break it to you, but actually, he is not. It is a sad reality, really. Jesus is the ruler over all those who believe in him, and unfortunately, not all of the people within the earth believe in him. And as a result, the so-called prince of the earth, better known as the devil, is currently the ruler. You see, in the first Epiphany, it is made clear to us that Jesus is the Son of God, and being part of the Trinity, God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, this means that Jesus is the Creator God, the one who made us all. So, in essence, all of creation belongs to him, for he made it all with God the Father and the Holy Spirit. And through his manifestation on earth, through his death and resurrection, we have been given a chance to call God our Heavenly Father and our King. So, although we, those who proclaim Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, belong to Jesus Christ, although he is our King, the rest of the world is trapped under the devil's rule, until the second Epiphany happens. In the second Epiphany, it is said that Jesus will fully overthrow the devil, and he, Jesus, will be the King of the earth. And this is where our text comes in. For it is under the rule of Jesus Christ that all people will be judged in righteousness, and that justice will be brought to afflicted ones. The psalmist goes further to describe what it will be like under the rule of Jesus Christ. According to him, the mountains will bring prosperity to the people, the hills the fruit of righteousness. It is said that Jesus, our King, will defend the afflicted, those who are oppressed and vulnerable. He will save the needy and the children of the needy, and he, Jesus, will take the oppressor to task. Or as the psalmist puts it, he will crush the oppressor. The psalmist then moves to describe the enduring and everlasting reign of Jesus Christ, when he writes, "He will endure as long as the sun, as long as the moon, through all generations." The reign of Jesus as King over all the earth is then compared to some of the most beautiful, nourishing, and life-giving phenomena on earth. As the psalmist puts it, he will be like rain falling on a mown field, like showers watering the earth. And under Jesus' rule, this Messiah, righteousness will flourish, and prosperity will abound. The psalmist goes one step further when he says that, when this Messiah, Jesus, is King, he will not only rule over every single part of the earth, but so too will other earthly rulers bow down to him. And anyone who requires help and care, those who are weak, vulnerable, oppressed, they all will be taken care of. And this brings us to our final point this morning, being in harmony with Jesus. Now you might stop me and say, "All right, Ams, I understand that the second Epiphany, where Jesus Christ will be the King over all the earth, is something to look forward to hope for, and to be continuously prepared for. But until that day or time, what am I to do now?" Although the second Epiphany has not happened yet, the first one has. So, in essence, Jesus Christ is here and among us, and for those who proclaim him as their Lord and Savior, he is within us as well. With that knowledge then, the question that comes to the fore is, are you in harmony with Jesus? Have you ever been asked a question or given a word, and in your mind you can actually picture or hear what someone has asked you or said to you? Now, that happens to me when I hear, among other things, the word harmony. In my mind, I can actually picture and hear the definition of this word. You see, harmony is generally defined as the combination of simultaneously sounded musical notes to produce a pleasing effect. Now, usually when different musical notes are in harmony, they form a specific sound, a distinct sound that constitutes one unit out of different parts, a sound that, strangely enough, works together, a sound that is pleasing to the ear. To be in harmony with Jesus Christ is very much the same thing, or very similar, at least. When we are in harmony with Jesus, we become one with Jesus, even though we are different. We learn his ways, who he is, and all that he has done. More than this, however, being in harmony with Jesus means becoming more like him, and as a result, that means portraying more and more of him in our lives. Thus, we become like that sweet melody. Who we are and how we live becomes pleasing not only to Jesus Christ and ourselves, but to all those around us as well. So the answer to the question of what are we to do now is to strive to live in harmony with our Creator God, our King, to live a life drenched in hope, peace, joy, and love until our time is finally finished. As I end off this morning, I would like to leave you with something to think about. Many years ago, Vincent van Gogh, or Vincent van Gogh, depending on your home language, asked a question, and the question goes, what would life be if we had no courage to attempt anything? Now, every year, either before or on New Year's Day or a little while after, we are prone to ask one another, what is your New Year's resolution or goal this year? And most of the time, our answers to this question greatly differ from one another. This year, however, what if you approached your New Year's resolution or goal differently? Instead of the usual, what if you did the unusual? What if you had the courage to live a life that is in harmony with Jesus Christ? What if your New Year's resolution was to live a life that portrays the hope, peace, joy, and love all year round? What if your New Year's resolution or goal was to portray Jesus in all you do? What if your New Year's resolution was to take delight in the Lord and to be holy and pleasing to him? Perhaps it is time to ring out a strong and beautiful melody, a distinct sound, one that is sweet, smooth, and in complete harmony with Jesus Christ. A sound that drowns out the negativity and violence in this world. A sound that proclaims our Savior, Jesus Christ, as the King above all kings. Amen. Come let us bow our heads, come let us pray. Thank you, Lord God, for this wonderful day, Lord. Thank you, Lord God, that we could wake up and realize that not only are we alive, Lord God, but so too have we been spared another year. Father, today, this first Sunday of a new year, we celebrate your revelation to us in Jesus Christ. And through meditation on our text written by the psalmist, Lord, we have come to see how there are two epiphanies. In the first one, Lord, Jesus Christ is revealed to us as our Lord and Savior, the only one who can save us from our sins, the only one who can give us a fighting chance. The second epiphany, however, Lord, is one that is only truly known by you, Father God. It is one in which Jesus Christ will rule over all the earth as its and our King. The second epiphany is a day or moment to look forward to, Lord God, a moment that inspires hope, strength, and endurance. But until such time, Lord God, it is here at the foot of the cross that we have come to ask for your help. We ask that you will help us be in harmony with Jesus Christ, Lord, that we may live a life that radiates you, that we may live a life that is like a sweet and ethereal melody, a melody that drowns out the negativity and violence in this world, a melody that makes known to all creation that Jesus is King. We pray this in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Come, let us conclude our service today in singing that wonderful song, Jesus, lover of my soul.
Receive now the blessing. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with us now and forevermore. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen.
Folks, once again our service has come to an end. Always feels so short, doesn't it? But it's been an honor and a privilege for both Amber-Leigh and myself to share with you today. And it is just a privilege to come into your house, to your business, your holiday home, wherever you may be, and just share the word of the Lord with you. As we leave, may I just express my sincere gratitude for allowing us in. And may God bless you richly as you journey with Him through this brand new year 2022. So, until we meet again, stay safe, stay healthy, and always remember that Jesus is only a prayer away. Goodbye now.